Hi, I'm Claire. I'm a developer on the Direct3D team at Microsoft, and I'm here to talk about Sampler Feedback, which is a Direct3D feature available on PC and coming to Xbox Series X at launch. Sampler Feedback is a DirectX 12 Ultimate feature on Xbox Series X and on PC, and it's a GPU hardware feature, meaning it relies on GPU hardware. It's a way of uncovering information about texture sampling that until now has been opaque to the application. So to get into how sampler feedback works, it's helpful to describe about how texture sampling works in general. Texture sampling has been around since forever in 3D computer graphics and in Direct3D. When you draw some 3D geometry on the screen, it's helpful to decide what color to assign what pixel, right? That's the eternal problem. And so for sure you can programmatically calculate that if you want to. But sometimes it can be helpful to map a 2D image onto the surface of your geometry. So you might call that 2D image a texture. You might want to perform some interpolation involving values of that 2D image to the facets of the geometry so that it looks good no matter how the surface is angled or where it appears in the scene. This type of practice is so common in graphics that GPUs have been fundamentally designed for it. And this concept as a whole is generally called texture sampling. Over the years, texture sampling has evolved forward to include lots and lots of features. Related to this, textures have MIP levels, which is, you know, like there's a big version of the image when you need lots of detail, and then there's smaller versions of the image for when you don't need as much detail. And sometimes a sample can decide what MIP level to use based on calculating the gradient of the UV to the neighboring pixel, say, and if the gradient is small, then it's close up, and if it's large, then it's far away, and that way you can get a MIP level as appropriate. And then there's also filtering. When you sample, most of the time you don't just read from one place on the texture and call it good. Of course, it depends on the visual style of your scenario. If you're aiming for something more retro looking, then you know you might do something simpler. But most of the time, you'll use a type of filtering that does multiple reads and feeds them into some computation, and then use like an average or a weighted average or something else that's clever. There are a lot of different filter modes with different complexities. And so you could use, for example, linear filtering, which does four reads and then takes an average of the four results, let's say it'll look okay. Or you could do anisotropic filtering, which does a lot of reads and a bunch of math, and it'll look pretty good. A common thing I hear sometimes is, what's the difference between a sample and a load? Well, a load is just a read from a texture. It's really, really simple and cheap. A sample does way more things than that. There's the possibility of MIP level selection, and a sample has filtering. The takeaway, though, is that because of details around MIP level selection and filtering, and sometimes filtering that has a hand in MIP level selection, samplers are complicated. And the details of them are also opaque to you. When you run your shader, you have a sample operation that takes in a UV and gives you back a sampled value. So you know what was sampled that way, but you don't know where. You don't know what MIP level was sampled, and more specifically, you don't know where on that MIP level. And most of the time, this is actually fine. Most of the time, you might not care. But sometimes you will. So now that we've talked about what texture sampling is, we'll cover why you might want to know what you sampled. So the scenario of texture streaming. So nowadays, displays are getting larger. That means that textures are getting larger. 4K textures is not something altogether uncommon to be hearing about. And textures take up memory, and the amount of memory you have is finite. You know, that's the eternal computer graphics problem. And so the reality is you might not be able to store 4K MIP zeros, 8K MIP zeros of all versions of all textures in your memory all at the same time. And indeed, it might not even make sense to do that. You know, it depends on your scene. If you might be that not all objects in the scene are even visible that use certain versions of that texture. It might be that all those objects are far away. So what do? When you can't keep full resolution versions of your texture in memory? And well, there what you do is that you don't. You can keep lesser detailed MIPs resident and then load up the more detailed ones when you need them on demand. You could maybe page out the ones that you don't need in a long time. This is a really typical thing to do. So there's a couple of different approaches to this idea. One way is to allocate a partial MIP chain, which includes the lower level of detailed MIPs only. And then when you need more detail, you do a copy to a fuller MIP chain. Copy is kind of expensive, but hey, it's for a good cause. It saves memory, so it could be worth it. And then another way is to allocate a full MIP chain, but only keep the texture data partially resident. This is a bit more modern way of doing things. It uses some newer features. It uses something called reserve resources in Direct3D 12 or tiled resources in Direct3D 11. you allocate a texture, but you don't commit any actual memory up to it up front. You can commit memory to it only in places where you're going to see it get used. And that memory commitment is actually even finer than a permit basis. It's on a per tile basis, where a tile is however much texture fits into 64K. No matter how you manage texture residency, whether it's full MIP chain or partial MIP chain, you have some decisions to make about what to load and when. Like, when do you load that 4K MIP zero? Well, maybe something tried to sample from it. Well, how would you know that? Because samplers are opaque, you don't have a built-in way of knowing. You can try to calculate MIP level selection yourself. Maybe you can be really clever. Maybe you can emulate the filter mode of the sampler that you're using in the shader. Maybe you can try to be really precise about emulating it, but it's really, really hard. And if you're using Todd resources, it's even harder, because it's not enough just to know what MIP level you're going to end up with. You need to know where on that MIP level. So if you combine that with use of like anisotropic filtering or something, trying to emulate that choice of where you sample from and all the set of places that it could have sampled from, it's prohibitively hard. It's just deal-breakingly hard. So enter sampler feedback. Sampler feedback is a way of opening up that black box so you can find out what MIPs you tried to sample from. And it goes a step further than that. It will tell you what parts of those MIPs. So one thing to know is that sampler feedback is not a complete overhaul of sampling hardware, but it's an extension to it. It's a GPU hardware feature that extends existing hardware designs and gets you something new out of what used to be that closed black box. So putting it all together into a streaming system, you can keep a residency map, which is, say, some texture which stores a list of what MIPs are resident. And then aside from that, you can store a feedback map, which contains what's been requested. And so integrating this into your streaming system, you can keep updating your residency map and have that feed into your decisions about what to load next. So we just talked about texture streaming as a scenario. Separately, we'll talk about texture space shading. So texture space shading is a 3D graphics rendering technique. You might not see it everywhere, but it's worth calling out here in this context because it's a technique that can be made more performant with sampler feedback. Texture space shading is a way of decoupling the shading of an object in world space from the rasterization of that object to the final target. See, normally in a forward render without texture space shading, when you draw a lit textured object to the screen, how many lighting computations do you do? Well, there's one for each invocation of the pixel shader. And so that scales with the number of screen space pixels that your object is taking up. But what if you've got a facet of your object that's angled almost in parallel with the direction vector of your camera? Well then, two neighboring screen space pixels of that facet will correspond to very different locations in world space. The lighting could vary a lot between locations in world space, and you're only calculating lighting a handful of times for that collection of screen space pixels. So there's a potential for numerical instability, and it could cause lighting artifacts. And then one other thing is that you might not want to compute lighting every frame. You know, lighting is expensive. It's maybe more expensive than any other shader operation you're doing. So maybe you want an easy way to reuse lighting computations across multiple frames, but still rasterize in screen space so that things look smooth as they're animating. So that's where texture space shading comes in. Texture space shading is a technique where you do all your lighting computations in object space and write them to a texture. And then later when you rasterize, you just sample from that texture. It's really cheap. So it already has the lighting computations built in. I mean the content. So that the contents of that texture already has the lighting computations built in. And so since your sampler can use a bunch of smoothing kinds of filtering, then any weirdly angled surfaces shouldn't suffer from as many lighting artifacts. Implicit with this technique is a need for mapping locations of the surface of an object to locations in world space. Fortunately, that's a very familiar idea. You know, we have the idea of a UVW unwrap. So if you wanted to, you could use your UVW unwrap to do that mapping. And if you go ahead with implementing this technique, though, one thing you might encounter as an obstacle is knowing what in object space to shade. I mean, yeah, you could shade everything, I guess, but that would be pretty wasteful, right? Like, what if not all facets of an object are visible? What if some of them are occluded? What if some of them are never even seen in the scene? You'd have a problem there where you'd have wasted performance, basically. You'd have a bunch of lighting computations that you just throw away. So one thing you could do is optimize your lighting computations by recording which texels in object space are being requested and then only performing lighting on those. So to recap, Sampler feedback is one feature with two scenarios, texture streaming and texture space shading. So what I covered are some of the reasons we want a concept like sampler feedback. Now I'll get into how it works in Direct3D. Sampler feedback is exposed as a new kind of ID3U12 resource. There are two new DHGI formats to go along with that, min-mip opaque and mip region used opaque. So important with that is the word opaque. The representation of feedback maps in D3D12 is that they're opaque, meaning the actual contents of the feedback map are up to the IHV and hidden away from the application for the most part. You don't sample from these resources, you don't read them like a normal UAV, you don't try to lock the bits and read them back directly. Instead, you do a decode to get the feedback back in a platform-independent form that you can inspect. The decode happens through the API resolve subresource region. You probably know that API. And there are two new resolve modes for making that happen. Encode sampler feedback and decode sampler feedback. It's more likely you'd use the decode one, but the encode one is there too for symmetry's sake. The way sampler feedback works is a GPU feature. It's also worth calling this out here, is that you get feedback for regions of pixels rather than for single pixels at a time. So this way you don't waste memory and you don't need to double up on memory just for using this feature, right? Because that would kind of defeat the point. So for MIP regions, it's such that you can think of one texel in the feedback map corresponding to a rectangular region in the texture that you're writing feedback for. In the interest of not overloading the word tile anymore, this is called a MIP region. And the smallest possible MIP region is 4x4 textures, but you can have them any size you want, so long as the dimensions are power of 2, and they don't have to be square. So one tip for integration into your streaming system, if you're using full MIP chain-based, reserve resource-based streaming systems, you might want to make the MIP region size the same size as the tile size. And then there are two flavors of feedback map. The first one is called min-mip. You could also call it min-lod if you prefer that. It stores what's the highest detail MIP level that got sampled. So if something requested MIPs 0, 1, and 3, it'll just store 0. And this makes a lot of sense for a streaming system, right? Because if something requested MIP 0, you can just load in MIP 0. You don't care about the request for MIPs 1 and 3 in that example. And then if nothing got sampled, when you decode, it'll just return 0xFF. The other type is MIP region used. So for that, it will tell you exactly what MIP levels are requested. So if something requested 1, 3, and 5, you'll get back 1, 3, and 5. And yes, it's always strictly possible to get min MIP from MIP region used, but they're both there in the API as a convenience. MIP region use could be interesting to non-texture streaming based applications of sampler feedback, like texture space shading or something else fancy. Really precise information about what MIPs were requested could be used to inform some level of detail computations that you're doing in your rendering. So for creating these things, you're going to want to use the revved create committed resource or create placed resource. You won't see create reserved resource because feedback maps themselves are not tiled. But you plug in to create committed resource or create placed resource, one of these two new DHGI formats. And then these new creates have been revved to take a D3D12 resource desk 1 instead of D3D12 resource desk. Desk 1 has a field added to it called sampler feedback MIP region. You're going to want to set that field to the sampler feedback MIP region, like 4x4 or whatever you're using. And then for binding, there is a new API for that. Create sampler feedback unordered access view. You pass in the feedback map resource and what texture you plan to get feedback for, and it creates a descriptor. And that descriptor is a special kind of UAV. It's one that's locked down a little bit in terms of what you can do with it. You use a UAV style register name like U0, U1, or so on in your HLSL, but there are new HLSL objects that you use with it to fulfill the shader semantics part of the binding. And then just one note for clearing. Yeah, you use good old clear unordered access view uint for that. As for writing feedback in your shader, there are new shader model 6.5 objects which expose 4 new HLSL methods. So these methods might look a little bit familiar to you. You might notice that they correspond to sample, sample bias, sample grad, and sample level. The first two methods, write sampler feedback and write sampler feedback bias, are for pixel shader only because they rely on an implicit gradient, which is a feature of invocation of the pixel shader through the rasterizer. The other two take an explicit gradient or explicit MIP level, so you can use them from any stage. putting it all together, there's some example code of using sampler feedback to drive texture streaming decisions. So if you look here, there's a residency map, G underscore residency, and a feedback map, G underscore feedback. We sample from the residency map and store it as min resident LOD, and we pass mid resident LOD to one of the overloads of sample to do a clamp of MIP level. That way you don't ever sample from a non-resident MIP. And then we call write sampler feedback using gfeedback and gtexture. So you might notice something about the semantics of write sampler feedback. You notice it looks very similar to sample. That's by design. The idea for that is you don't need to understand filtering mode or anything like that. You don't need to dissect any of that information. You just use the same kinds of semantics as sample. And that way you can write feedback. A couple of performance frequently asked questions. First of all, does it cost something to write feedback? Yes, it does. Like many things in computer graphics, it's not free. So what you might want to not do is write feedback on literally every texture request. You're likely to get a ton of redundant requests. If you're talking one feedback write per shaded pixel, that's overhead you don't want. So what you might want to do instead is do a stochastic discard. We did some experimentation and found good results with something like a 99% discard, where you write feedback, say, 1% of the time. Depending on your random number generating algorithm, you might want to do it 128th of the time. We tested, and the overhead from that is very small. And then another thing is, what if you have a lot of like size, like formatted textures? Like, for example, if you have one material that has a diffuse map, a normal map, a specular map, and they're all the same size, for that, you might want to keep the textures in a texture array rather than in two or more distinct resources. That way you can allocate a feedback map array that corresponds with that array. And in HLSL, there's versions of the feedback writing methods that write to elements of the array. So although feedback maps tend to be small, allocating them as an array can let you allocate them more efficiently, because array elements tend to not incur as much wasted memory due to texture alignment requirements on the GPU compared to, say, separate textures completely. This is especially true of small textures. So one other thing is that there is PIC support for sampler feedback. You can capture applications that use sampler feedback, and you can also view the feedback maps themselves in PICs. And this is coming soon in March 2020. So that's about it. To get started with sampler feedback, you can grab the latest Windows 10 Insider preview build and the SDK preview build for Windows 10. And then the latest DirectX shader compilers that you can get at the new shader model 6.5 features. And then grab a compatible GPU and driver, for example, NVIDIA Turing driver version 450.56 or later. And then you can get in touch with us on Mixer or at Discord at discord.gg/directx with any questions or feedback.